everyone, and welcome to the Sarah Dev Stream.
Hello.
Joined here by Nathan Mooney, James Karen.
What's up? I am your host, community manager, KL Smith, and today we have a pretty fun stream. It's a little different. We had some weather kind of mess with our normal dev stream. We had a snowstorm essentially over the weekend. Snowstorm by North Carolina.
By North Carolina standards.
Let's be real here. And so a lot of our dev studio is out today. Probably like 70% of the studio is out. So we can't hold a normal dev stream. People aren't able to show up. So we decided, Mooney and I and James trudged over here through the inclement and horrific weather outside.
Oh God, it is terrible.
Brave the elements.
Icy. It's a little icy.
I almost got attacked by an Arctic wolf on my way here.
Did you?
Yeah.
I almost slipped. That's about it. I almost slipped, guys. That's it. So yeah, I walked over here and so did Mooney and James. And so we wanted to bring you guys a little bit different stream. James is on the Comp QA team. And for Sarath, we wanted to still show you guys gameplay of Sarath, but talk about her from a gameplay standpoint, about how you play her, what types of strategies you all can implement from, folks playing over in Comp. And just get your mind kind of thinking about how you would interweave Sarath and build her into the existing heroes and team composition. So this should be a really fun stream. It's a little different, a little light. We will come back on Wednesday with a community stream from two guys that we'll have out, artists.
Yeah.
Is it Miso Sneaky?
Yeah, the Sneakies, yeah.
And they will be kind of doing a rendition of Sarath live. So it'll be our first time doing that. Starting the new year out with our first dev stream here on and first hero release on Monolith, which is also pretty exciting. So before we get started, there's a couple things that we want to talk through just from a community standpoint. And the first one is that for the community events updates, we let you guys know with Crunch's release that that was the last time we were going to do a hero race. We are rebuilding and restructuring and figuring out events that we want to hold for 2017. And the community team and the publishing team and the dev team are all working together to figure out what's going to be the most impactful for you guys this year for events. So there will be no hero race with the release of Sarath. Instead, we're going to continue to encourage that you guys show us your cool plays. Mm-hmm. We'll be retweeting those and showing those on Twitter and Facebook and things like that.
Yep, for sure. So, hashtag Paragon Plays.
Paragon Plays. The Paragon Competitive League had their tournament over the weekend. We featured them in-game. I want to say they had around 2,000 viewers.
Yeah, peaked out around there.
So they were formerly Agora Rising. So shout out to those guys. Reborn actually won the tournament. I believe they won 2-1. And the other, I misspelled that, but the other tournament series that's kind of been going on has been the Paragon Challenger Series, which has been mostly kind of held by the European folks and players. But also shout out to those guys because they had several tournaments and stuff over the break while we were basically on holiday. So again, lots of fantastic community stuff. I wanted to point those out before kind of delving into the release of 36. You guys, for those of you guys that remember, we will release heroes on our 0.1 releases, and now we're actually going to our 0.0 releases. Yeah. So going forward with the release of like 36 and then 37 and 38, those will be hero releases. So V36 is coming in. We're having a number of changes with this. This build.
Yeah. So V36, which will be dropping tomorrow, we posted a TLDR of the patch notes coming tomorrow. We're, getting all this prepped, coming back from the holidays, getting the notes ready for you guys tomorrow. So we wanted to post a TLDR for you guys today to get you updated. We can talk through some of the notes here.
Yeah.
We got some awesome optimization changes coming in, which are going to improve load times by 30% for PC and PS4. So that's going to be awesome because I know like a lot of people have, or some of the people having trouble, coming over the Monolith or people coming back to the game, loading into the game. It's very helpful and it's good for a lot of people on the lower end. With Bellica, I wanted to point out two major bug fixes that we have. People have been kind of talking about the bug with Bellica being unable to move after using her ultimate. A lot of people talk about that. We have a fix in for that for V36. and as well as the jungle buff bug a lot of you have been pointing out on the forums and Reddit, with where the jungle buff was not attacking the enemies who were blocking the target.
Gold buff.
Yeah, it was a gold buff, and there were some the jungle buff enemies across the board.
Okay.
So it's helped, you know, not fixing that issue just overall. We have some adjustments to core. So the core is changing. The core damage is you know, coming up, and we're increasing the base attack time as well. So we'll have those notes in there to keep an eye out for those. Some additional jungle buff changes with black buff, you know, showing number pops correctly into one tick. And we fixed an issue where we had some issues with the tutorial giving XP incorrectly, and then a bug with players who are receiving kill credit assist if they are dead. So
that's a big one.
That was a big one as well. So a lot of players have been running into that. I know you've seen that.
Yeah, so we've seen posts about it on the forums, on Reddit, tweets about it, personal messages about it.
Yeah.
So there was a bug that went in that we caught where players were not receiving their kill credit and their correct amount of card experience if they got an assist and they died, right? So, you know, you engage in a fight, let's say you were a support or something like that, you know, you got a thunk off or a stun, a stasis bomb, and, you know, your teammates killed 2-3 guys, and then, but you died out of that, you would not get credit for it or the card experience. That has been fixed and addressed now. So hopefully the fix goes in and it's working, and people are happy. Get your happy face on now that that's been fixed.
Yeah, and we also have you know, some changes to the cards. We're adjusting the values on a lot of the new cards coming over to Monolith. So, you know, keep an eye out for the full release notes tomorrow. We'll have like a full granular version. We're also to call out specifically Cast Converter and Blood Catalyst.
Yeah, so Cast Converter, was it Blood Catalyst that we removed or Cast Converter? I can't remember which one. Health Regen. It was the one with Mana Regen.
Yeah.
So Blood Catalyst will come back, and both Blood Catalyst and Cast Converter are being reworked. As you guys know, there was kind of an unintentional exploit where you could basically get a lot of mana and a lot of health back really quickly using Cast Converter. So that has been addressed, and it was in tandem with the river buffs, and they'll be coming back reworked. The other one that I think is important to call out is Honor the Pure and Barrier of Will. There's a rework coming in for those with V36. We saw a lot of folks using it during the tournament because you can kind of stack your shields. That is being addressed, and the active is going to be called Team Shield. Team Shield active now costs 100 mana, and any ally, including yourself, affected by a Team Shield when you activate Honor of the Pure, Barrier of the Will, cannot activate or benefit from another Team Shield for 15 seconds. So there won't be that kind of constant stacking
the shields,
of shields, which teams have been kind of using to their advantage. So those are changes that are coming in with V36. In addition to Seraph, if you guys all saw the announced trailer, a lot of excitement.
Oh, yeah.
Can we show that? Do we have that?
I don't have that.
Okay, that's fine. And talk through some of the changes that we have coming to her with James. James, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Pretty good. So from a strategy side, we typically have you know, one of the designers over here with us. What was it like kind of going through the iterative process for Seraph with you guys? Were you guys bouncing off a lot of ideas?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what kind of what kind of foothold did you kind of have in that process of helping her get to where she's at now?
Gotcha. So it was really challenging because this is our first melee carry. We wanted to see what a melee carry would look like in Paragon.
Mm-hmm.
So the process was kind of just like, my role in that was just playing her a lot,
right?
And just kind of seeing like where she wasn't accomplishing the goals we set out for her, mm-hmm. and then discussing with design how to move forward with those goals, how to more effectively complete those.
Okay. And from your interactions with the team for comp, what type of roles were you kind of placing her in throughout the matches that you guys kind of had with her?
So first and foremost, we wanted to make sure she worked as a carry. Mm-hmm. That is a safe lane carry, being the main farmer for a team, being able to carry a game when she hit that critical mass. Like, that was the number one priority.
Right.
I would say she ended up being a fairly versatile hero. There are different roles that she can fit, which is a really cool wrinkle to her. Almost everybody in our room has like a different way they like to play her as far as like build path goes. There's a lot of viable things with her.
How have you been playing her mostly?
So I play her as a melee carry like normal, but I also like to take her mid a lot. Yeah. I think she benefits a lot from the solo XP in mid. And also, anybody that has gone mid in Monolith knows it's quite dangerous.
Yeah.
And she's really elusive. She's difficult to pin down, difficult to kill. And that's an attribute I feel you need as an effective mid laner. So.
Okay. That's cool. And what type of strategy, when you're thinking about how to be the most effective with her, do you kind of employ when you're going in? Is it heavily team composition based? And when the team composition isn't optimal, what type of plays are you looking to capitalize on?
Gotcha. So if I'm the main damage dealer for my team comp, if I'm playing Seraph, my philosophy is I put a lot of emphasis on crit chance and lifesteal. Reason being, her Q when she's using Heaven's Fury, every hit she does to an enemy counts as an LMB. So you can crit in that form. You can sustain with lifesteal in that form. So I like to emphasize that and just get those big damage or those big sustains while I'm invincible. It's kind of like good synergy there.
Right.
And there's also strong synergy with her ult because people that are burning take additional LMB damage and they also do less damage. So if they're doing less damage to you, but you're doing more damage to them and you're sustaining off of that, like that's one way that the delta increases.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, that's really cool. So Heaven's Fury, which we'll probably talk about as we start showing gameplay, that is her ability where it's kind of like an AoE and she does like these matrix like hits on people, mm-hmm. if I'm not mistaken, like she like disappears. And...
Yeah.
Okay. It's really cool. We'll show that once we hop in the game specifically. Yeah. but yeah, I mean, we're watching the gameplay. When I go through for the solo specific gameplay, then, I specifically talk to some of those abilities that you use. Now, What type of hero do you feel like in team composition do you feel like she really synergizes with?
So if she is the main damage dealer, that is to say the safe lane carry, she synergizes greatly with a range support, really important for her laning phase, so she doesn't get bullied by an offlaner. She struggles if it's her and like another melee support against like a ranged offlaner, for instance. Sorry, what was the question?
Yeah. Maybe? So when what other heroes does she synergize with? Gotcha. When building a team composition.
So she gets a decent amount out of AoE also, believe it or not, because of her ult when she pops, it's an AoE burn around her. Her Q's AoE, RMB if you're using it for damage, taking your life in your own hands, also AoE. but yeah, anybody like Faye, I feel like is very good with her because Faye brings everybody together and it lets her apply like her burn on a whole team. And that's the most effective use case for her ult.
Okay.
I'm resisting making I'm not resisting it, but like her potentially burning face plants is a concern also if you bring together. So you have to keep that in mind if you're building team comp.
You gotta be careful about when you press R and get Faye in your team.
I imagine she'd be good with Decker as well because you could kind of do the whole
corral them.
Well, yeah, I always hear that joke with like Crunch, you put him in the boxing ring with Crunch,
right?
And then you just like have Crunch take him out. I imagine something similar. Seraph pops ultimate, you keep the enemies in an area, she can apply that ultimate, let the mages kind of help out on your team as well.
Yeah, the box serves a similar function. It can be hit or miss though. If she has a lead and she wants to be sitting there like dueling with people, the box is really good. But sometimes her playstyle is more like targets of opportunity.
Right.
You don't want to be just in there like trading with somebody,
And while we were kind of talking about the stream before we got on, you mentioned using her as utility. Mm-hmm. Can you kind of explain the mentality behind how you would apply that? Let's say she's not necessarily the main damage dealer, but you want to utilize her utility and maybe play her off lane, for example.
Gotcha.
Can you kind of explain the thought process of how that would be effective in game?
Yeah, for sure. So another reason that she works well in the solo lane, like we said in mid, is it's very difficult to kill her. She has a really good escape. I could see a world where people are picking her in a composition mainly for the weaken aspect of her ult. So you just put her in a team comp as an off laner. And her role is less so like damage dealing, killing people, and more so is like team utility. Your role is when you're fighting to just get in and apply burn to as many people as you can, so those people are just like doing damage. So you're effectively indirectly tanking damage for the rest of the team if you can, right. if you can pull that off.
Okay. That would be a very interesting place. I would love to see some of the creative ways that people decide to play heroes really applied in game. And you were talking about kind of waiting to see that high skill level of play and then seeing the highlight reels for Seraph. Is there like specific moments where you've had in comp where it's like, oh yeah, that's a highlight? And like what types of plays kind of happen when you're playing as her?
So yeah, there've been a few big moments. So she needs like a little bit of setup for those moments, I feel like. Like every time that has happened, it's been like somebody else on the team has also made a great play, like a Muriel ult at the right time or something. Right. Muriel, really good synergy. We kind of glossed over that. But yeah, it's usually like that. You don't really want to start fights with her. If you manage to come in at that like right time where it's like if there's a steal on the other team, they've like used steal ult. Or like one of their big team fight things has been like burned, no pun intended. And you kind of just like come in at the right time and you're more like a cleanup role. Like you want to have that timing to where it's like you're full health, but everybody's like beat up just a tiny bit. And at that point, you're pretty much running the fight. It's very difficult to get away from Seraph.
So do you go with and engage with Ascend in those situations? Or do you save it maybe? And I talked about having Blink. Do you go in with a Blink and then try to engage when people are weak? Or do you save your Ascend for escapes?
So I would say probably 80% of the time you want to save Ascend for escapes. A lot of the challenge you're going to have when playing Seraph is being able to get in position to do your thing without using abilities or Blink. If you can do that, then you're already like kind of a step ahead.
Okay.
You can use Ascend to go in. I would say that's probably you only want to do that if it's like guaranteed that you're going to kill somebody or there's no way it's going to go wrong for you or it's like a team fight scenario where they're running away. Like you really want to be extremely exacting with how you're using Ascend.
Okay.
When nothing's going to go wrong for you is exactly when something will go wrong for you. That's, that's the one problem. And what you're speaking about is kind of the one interaction I had. I remember just playing in a playtest and we were not focusing the Seraph because we had caught somebody out. And I think she'd gone around to the side. I was playing Richter, and I went over to like go hook her. And I was like, "Hey guys, I got Seraph." And I was like, "Oh no, I do not."
No.
And then she just turned around. I saw the wings like flare up, the fire show up, and I was just like, "Oh, okay, I guess all of us are dead over here." And then it was the situational is that she had two of us in front of the fog, while the other two were dealing with teammates. So she easily turned around, and was like, "You guys are in a disadvantaged position. This is more advantageous to me because your team doesn't have vision on you, and I'm able to kind of just." Go at you, take you out. Like, it was me, Richter, and I think Arcari. And Arcari wasn't expecting her to have her ultimate up because she came in at that right time in the team fight to capitalize on us not having our abilities up. So
yeah, having that timing and awareness of when to go in, it sounds like it's very important as an aspect of gameplay. One of the things I was just thinking about when you said that is if you don't have your eye on Seraph in the fight, and you can more speak to this, it sounds like she's going to be very dangerous.
Yeah, that's a kind of common thing. You'll think you like have a fight won, and then you'll hear the sound of her ult going off because you just completely forgot about her, and all of a sudden she's cleaning people up.
Right.
Yeah, if you want like a blow-by-blow, I can give you a blow-by-blow of the best Seraph play I've ever made, personally.
Yeah, sure.
No, I would love to hear this.
All right, cool. So check it out. They were trying to do Raptors, the enemy. And my team had like started the fight and I was like, all right, are we going into this? Because if I'm going in, I'm either going to kill everybody or I'm going to die. And they said, yes, we're going to fight. So the fight started, I'm on like the edge, like just giving the mace to Howitzer or something like that. And then they all turn to me. My Muriel ults me. I ult. It's really, the timing is really important, not just like where you're standing and what you're doing, but when you're actually using the ult. Like you don't want to pop it immediately. Like in this particular fight, it was a good like six wings before I ulted because that was when I could hit the most amount of people.
Okay.
So at this point, everybody's burning. They're all looking at me, but I'm getting Muriel shields and they're all like half health anyway. And they just pretty much get like ran through. At the end, I have to like run out. So there's like their TB and there's me. I have no health left. And so does he, but he's like hit me with Ventilate. My team eventually cleans him up. But yeah.
Yeah, sounds good.
That's like, and I one thing I'm also excited for, and I'm sure like has happened, is we were talking about this earlier, is the using the Heaven's Fury, because during that you are untargetable, correct?
Yes.
So it's like one of those things where you could use that kind of to outplay in a team fight almost as a second utility skill if using it on the fight. Like say you come up on that Howitzer and he tries to like pull some shenanigans with the mine, and you hit him with the Heaven's Fury, and all of a sudden, you know, he uses one mobility skill on an aggressive play, and your team has him caught out now. Like, things like that. Did that happen at, like, a rate of occurrence? Is this something you expect to be a normal part, or more of just, like, if you can use it this way, use it this way, but generally it'll be your tool for farming in lane and stuff.
So that's actually something really good you touched on. I think that that is going to be what separates normal slash good Seraph players from like the really good ones, is she's just such a nuanced hero. And especially with how you use the Q, like, yes, you could just use it to do damage, but best case scenario, you're using it to do damage while also negating damage or negating something big, you know?
Okay. That sounds like it'll be very important. Now, for those that don't know, Seraph is Order and Corruption. I can't remember if we mentioned that or not, and I'm pretty sure it's in the announce blog, but I want to start off with that. And I wanted to show Clint the in-game screen, so take us over to being in-game. Yes. So I was going to have James walk us through building a deck for Seraph. Now, this is a new, this is my one of my playtest accounts for internal builds. So I don't have all the cards unlocked. I have all the cards unlocked.
Level 7, Kale?
Hey, come on, guys. Everyone knows that I have more master skins than you.
Yeah.
Everyone knows.
This is true. I'm just taking what I can. I'm just, this is the one account I can talk about. So it's.
Sheesh. This guy. All right, so before we start off, whenever we do the community streams, I know this is a big thing with the guys and girls that come on. They like to show the skins. So before I hop into that, let's look at the skins. All right, so right now I actually have the Challenger skin on. This is her base skin. You guys can see.
Nice, perfect mix. Good mix of gold and silver.
Very regal.
Yeah.
Here's the all silver. Again, very regal.
Yeah, no, it's
pristine.
That's how I would keep armor if I had armor. I would hope that armor. I wouldn't, but I would hope. Like, that'd be goals, right?
You don't even have that's the armor fortitude goals. To get master skin.
That's damn.
I know how you would treat.
I'm getting personal over here.
I know how you would treat them.
All right.
And then here is the tier one skin that we'll release that you guys can purchase called Blood Gold Seraph. This one is very nice. Very, very nice. I like it quite a bit. You guys can see I can buy all the things right now. Let's just go ahead and do this just because I'm going to buy it on live. By the way, all of us should be buying this one on live because it looks awesome.
I have it already.
Oh, see? There you go. Mooney.
Yeah, I'll buy it. Yeah, I'm going to buy it.
I just had to make sure. All right, so let's walk through a deck with Seraph. Cool. We'll call this the James Cairn Special. James is going to walk us through making this deck. So when you're thinking about how you want to build her, what's your first pick from a prime card? You go with Warlord or Archmagus?
Yeah, I always go Greedlord. I take Warlord.
Okay.
Whoops. We can compromise. We can do Archmagus.
That's really the correct name, the Greedlord. Yeah. I like that you said that.
Yeah, disclaimer, this is going to be Greedlord.
Yeah.
So it's so funny.
Oh, boy.
Oh, no. Oh. No, guys, don't do that. when we go through these, again, some of the cards I don't have, but you can talk through ones that would either be a good substitute
or just
directly to the ones that you think should be in here. And then we kind of look at those in the deck. So the one that you mentioned was Thirstfang, right? So I don't have Thirstfang on this, but I have it on live. And that would be a card that, you know, it might substitute. So think almost default deck build.
Default deck build. All right. So we don't have Thirstfang. All right. So once again, I like to play a little bit greedy because that's just how I do things. But if we didn't have the Thirstfang, and you wanted to be like a little safe early if you're worried about getting blown up, maybe I would go Adamant Edge.
Okay.
I would start with that and just put 3 1-point damage upgrades, flex a health upgrade if you're still concerned.
So we'll act like I have 3.
Yeah,
there you go.
Perfect.
So Adamant Edge, by the way, has power and health, and the fully upgraded bonus there is more power. So you get 3 points of power, plus the 50 points of health as well.
And so that doesn't seem like a very significant amount of health in a vacuum, but the amount of times you'll survive with like 30 HP on this build is really high, and her HP pool is so low that any increase in health is significant enough to feel it.
Okay.
Especially with the weaken.
Okay.
And this is cool because this is more like a we're trading out like a little more of an active sustain for a passive sustain.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Like I'm more resilient in the lane overall, meaning I may not die, but I'll go back with that less health. So like effectively, I'm removed from the lane, but I'm at least surviving enough to get back to lane, defend my tower and stuff, and don't have to sit in the lane for the sustain.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And the important thing is you're not dropping any damage by doing that.
Right. Right.
And then what about would you go two of these or one, or would you switch between amulet?
I would have an amulet and an adamant, an extra one in, just to flex, but I would not build those early.
Okay.
From here, I would go Spear of the Rift Hunter.
Spear of the Rift Hunter. Just down here.
A classic.
Yeah. Now, this is a little unorthodox, the way I like to do this build, but what I'll do is I will get this, and then I'll put 2 3-point damage upgrades in it, and then I'll just leave it. I will leave it until I finish Blade of Agora with 3 1-point upgrades. And then I'll come back to this, and I'll put a 3-point crit upgrade in it.
So 2 3-point damage upgrades with a 3-point crit ready to go.
Yep.
And then finish Blade of Agora, and then finish this. Okay.
So it looked like this?
Yeah.
Okay.
So when you do hit that Blade of Agora in, all of a sudden it's like a walloping power spike at that point for you.
Yeah.
Because you were finishing essentially two cards simultaneously. The goal is simultaneously.
Yeah, exactly. You're not going to have as many chances to crit with just the vanilla Spear of the Rift Hunter, but you do have that 4% chance to blow someone up.
Right.
And then it kind of all comes together when you put that 3-point crit upgrade in it. You have, I think, 24% chance to crit with fairly light investment, and the other important thing is you have enough damage behind that crit to where they're going to feel it. Like, you don't want to stack and rush crit early, because then you just end up with a bunch of really underwhelming crits. You want to make sure that they're going to actually feel the crits.
Be substantial, okay.
And the damage helps if you did have that Thirst Fang, the lifesteal earlier on, because you're getting that early burst of damage rather than the crit, so you have like this consistent sustained damage,
So typically exactly you start off with a Thirst Fang?
Like I said, it depends. If I anticipate a difficult lane or like a lot of pressure from a jungler, then yes, okay. I will have sustain.
Okay. So we're at... we're at...
so popular.
I'm just trying to get this friend code.
The same guy. Yeah. I would be careful, guys. We do have Curse of the Leech, which is very similar to that, except you get the
life
fully upgraded
the power,
power right. Instead of the lifesteal. So very similar. So we could technically go Curse of the Leech, right?
Yeah, I actually, in some cases, like that better. That's just 10% lifesteal for finishing the card. So you spend 7 points and you have, let me do some math real quick. You have 24 damage, you have 10% lifesteal. So sometimes you can just get like two of those with minimal investment, just put 1-point damage upgrades in each, and that's pretty much the lifesteal that you'll need.
So I'm going to build it a little different. We're going to go a 10-point, so we'll go twos. What's after this? So we're probably, so let's say Adamant is our first card, Spear of the Rift Hunter is next. And then
you get that
the Blade of Agora.
Blade of Agora.
Yeah.
Okay, so Blade of Agora here. And do you prioritize this as a 10-point, or is this like another 12-point card?
No, this is just straight up get it done as quick as you can.
Okay, so we'll go twos.
This is where we put the, if we had more miners, this is where we put them in, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Popular.
I want those friend codes.
This is an entertaining deck building for sure.
It is. I like it. I like being
a little bit
popular.
Tetris. Little bit.
Everyone is my. I think I have the most friends.
You have the most friends now.
Easily.
Yeah.
We're outside of this, but.
Anyway.
Go ahead. What's next?
At this point in the build, so if you have like a little bit of a lifesteal base and you have your crit done, what I like to get is I would buy a Whirling Wand and then put a 3-point lifesteal upgrade, attack speed upgrade in it. Reason being, it's right below. So lifesteal synergizes most effectively with attack speed as opposed to flat damage or anything else. And... yeah, you just want those quick hits. No more investment is really necessary. You can kind of all in on the attack speed if you want, but normally I'd just buy this, put the 3-point attack speed upgrade in, and start building other stuff and come back to it if I felt like I needed it. Otherwise, I just put damage in this. finished out with damage.
Kind of like a flex attack speed item if you're feeling like you require that at that point in the game.
Mm-hmm. Three. Exactly. Yeah. Like sometimes I just want some attack speed, but I don't want to super invest.
And then, so we got Blade, Curse, Whirling Wand, Spirit of the Rift Hunter, Adamant Edge. I think we're feeling, I'm feeling pretty good so far. I feel like you're going to take me into victory.
Yeah, so at this point, you're pretty much done with probably 70 to 80% of your build. It's just deciding what...
How do you flex?
Yeah, exactly. So most players probably will want more crit if you're just going glass cannon. At this point, we have a significant amount of crit, but we haven't really heavily invested in it. You can easily get up to like 50, 60% crit if you want to go that route, sacrifice some damage or health. I would usually go health at this point if I felt like I needed it, because health is a very effective stat for any carry. It seems a little bit of a conflict, but the longer you're staying alive, the more damage you can do, the better you're doing your role.
Is it like Elder Mage Amulet, you think?
I would go Amulet of the Veteran, because it's pure health, and just drop health in
just
it.
Just drop health?
Just drop health.
Right. Okay.
One of the things I like when we were talking about earlier with the utility is the great thing about Sereth is she is actually, like, because she's order, she has access to a lot of these, like, some of these active cards that are, like, very good, powerful support cards, like, you know, Pure
Honor, yeah, Pure,
Honor the Pure, you have, you know, Tempest Pearl, and that points towards some of the options we had spoken about earlier with her playing a little more utility.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, if you ever were to play her in that off from, like, one of those lanes and you notice, like, there was another carry, somebody on your team trying to, it was pretty far ahead, you wanted to supplement them, you pick up an Honor the Pure, maybe for a shield somewhere in the mid game.
Oh, absolutely.
It's a nice little pickup. Mm-hmm. Even if it's just for a team fight or something, it seems like it's a good option to have at least. Like, you have the option to play like a little bit more of a utilitarian role in team fights, which I always really liked, was you kind of the idea of like having a utility carry where like you are deadly in your own right, but you're like mitigating your points of weakness with utility.
Absolutely.
Would you actually go Honor the Pure? Have you tried that with her?
I wouldn't go if I was safe lane carry, but sometimes I would go it if I was being the mid laner, and if I was doing like the utility off lane thing, yeah, I would buy that first.
Okay.
I would understand not doing another melee carry because 6 points is a high amount of investment, even. Mm-hmm. Like, just in having it empty is kind of a hard hit to your damage, I'm sure.
Yeah, that's 6 points that you usually want on stats, but that said, it's an effective enough card to where there is some tension on that choice.
Mm-hmm. What type of, you know, like, 1 point start-out cards do you think they're consumables?
So, Greed Lording, once again, I might take a health pot.
Okay.
But it's either a health pot, 2 tokens, or 3 tokens, usually.
Okay.
But I do like to keep the mana pot and the sometimes the scout ward in the deck. Just in case. Yeah.
Always just in case.
Scout Ward is just, it's, there's no reason to not have it. It's really
and
strong.
How do you feel? I mean, I know you said that you don't run Blink Charm, but is it something that you have in your deck just in case, or typically not?
On almost every hero except for her.
Okay.
So that's just my preference. Obviously, there's a lot of good uses for it. Even like Stablink, you could probably find a use for it. Also, there's some people that really like Thunder Cleaver.
I was going to say, are you a Thunder Cleaver for Sereth?
I am not a Thunder Cleaver, no. But it is effective. There's some people that like to build it. There's definitely worth exploring.
Okay. I would. I am a Thunder Cleaver.
Thunder Cleaver.
Yep.
Yeah, because if you think about it, the active is like a guaranteed crit if it's just another attack.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
I think totally. If you use Thunder Cleaver, you're Thunder Clever. That's the description.
So, outside of this, I'm not sure what else I would pick. Do you any more? Do we need any more crit? Can we add that?
Yeah, I'd say it's nice to have.
Just like as a kind of like, hey, I've hit my break point, but I want to be a little bit more consistent with these. Because I always feel, for me personally at least, I'm like, when I'm on range, because the sparing times I do play ranger, or the carries, I tend to itemize like towards towards crit about like 30 to 40, and then after that point, I'm just like, I kind of like the RNG factor, and I want to see the bigger numbers.
Yeah.
That's a personal choice. I know, like, even talking to, like, Ed when he's making his carry builds and stuff, I know he's a little bit more, like, well-rounded with the build, but I'm a little bit more greedlord where I want to see the big, like, 800 damage crits, like, if I can get it up there. Because it's that to me, that's like, I hit the 800, I get that whatever, even the baseline 10% life, so I get, like, at least 80 to 100 life out of the couple of hits that I get off in the beginning of that fight, and maybe that gives me the difference in health to, you know, weaken and then just, you know, abuse the enemy team a little bit further.
So. Just widen that gap.
Right, right.
Yeah, I would say crit, it's definitely really attractive. In experimenting with it, I found if I really stack crit, then I get, like, a lot of crits, and they're fairly chunky. Like, we're talking 300 to 500. But you don't really get, like, those 6, those 7, those 800 crits that you were talking about. And I have felt that it's more impactful to have, like, the damage behind those crits and still crit fairly consistently at 24%, as opposed to just, like, 60% crit, but you're missing out on, I don't know, quite a bit of damage.
I like the, and I like the aspect of the lifesteal and, like, the crit because of the on-hit effect of the, of Heaven's Fury. Like, the idea of Heaven's Fury, because it really kind of adds a little bit more to that, the that skill later in the game. You can kind of, like, do a little bit more of a playing around a tower or something in this sieging, because we were kind of speaking about this earlier, and I mean, maybe it'll come up, it'll probably come up when we play through the game, but, like, her her sieging towers. Obviously, it's a point of, it may be a point of concern for some people, because, you know, melee carry versus ranged carry. You know, if you want to, can you talk about, like, some of, like, how she feels in laning versus, like, the throughout the rest of the game?
Gotcha. I would say, so you pick her in your safe lane if you're anticipating, like, fighting a lot, if you're drafting a team that, like, you have to win fights, you're planning to be PvPing a lot. If your strategy is kill and then push tower, then she excels over a majority of the rangers, I would say.
Okay. So one of the things I wanted, the reason why we loaded in the game versus doing the gameplay, I just want to talk very quickly about how you start your leveling for abilities. So what's your first choice when you playing her and you hop into a game?
So most of the time, you're going to want to have your E first. I mean, the best scenario is just to save your point until you need to spend it on something. But if you're just, like, picking something right off the bat, E is the way to go. Reason being, it's the only skill that's just straight up going to save your life. It's your escape. If you're caught off guard by anything, you really want to have that over anything else. And dying early can really kind of put you in a tailspin for the rest of the game. So it's really important that you're safe early on. That helps you do that.
Okay. And then from there, you said you have some cast tokens. You might go health pot. So we'll go health pot. I'll have the mana pot there just in case. And again, this is against bots. So should be okay. One of the things that I really loved about her in playtests was some of the things that you mentioned. It's just when you get in a position to be effective on the battlefield, like, you know, whether it be level or otherwise, it feels really rewarding to come in and clean up.
Yeah.
It feels very, very satisfying.
Like, I bided my time. I've been patient. I waited, you know, time.
Yeah,
Vision, played around the vision and came into the fight.
Yep.
And the sound when you hit somebody that's burning, too, is so satisfying.
There's her sin.
That's cool.
Which is fantastic. And then once you hit, you know, level 2, 3, 4, and we're going to hop back into gameplay here in a second. What types of things are you thinking about from leveling? Is it, let me level up now that I have Ascend, all right, that's my first pick, and then I focus on her Heaven's Fury, so I might, you know, skip out on the slow, which is, what is it, Chastise, or do you just go, you make sure your first three abilities are those?
Yeah, normally she is a hero. I would like to have a point in every ability at level 3.
Okay.
And then from there, Q and R&B, Chastise, are both very important to level, because the slow you get from Chastise is not super impactful at level 1, but it scales fairly satisfactorily. So you really start feeling that when it gets to be like level 3, level 4. But that said, I like to max Q first. Reason being is the cooldown gets to be really low at max level, so that's more opportunity to deal safe damage and also negate damage.
Okay, so I'll go Chastise. An enemy tower is under attack. And her Chastise ability, again, it looks really cool. Like I said, I feel like, you know, you take some of the, like, quick time movements, and she, you guys can see, like, she attacked all.
Oh, that's cool. I didn't know. That's cool. I didn't actually remember. I didn't see that.
And it's alluded to in the announce trailer.
Yeah.
So, like, when she's smacking all three of them, it's kind of like those flash frames. Mm-hmm. That's kind of what the ability looks like.
Yeah.
It's really awesome.
It's almost like the comic book, like she's coming in from the left and right. It's like bam, blash, blow.
Yeah.
She's just like hitting you and then going back to her normal position.
And one cool thing about the way the key works is you'll see at the bottom a status effect thing. It'll let you know how long you're actually going to be in that state. And there's also enemies can see that on your health bar. So both you and the enemies can play around your Q ability.
Okay.
Nice. So there's like, it starts becoming like an execution thing, like playing around Sereth's character, because you're playing around the abilities because you want to know whether she, you know, is going to be in that state where I'm going to be able to deal damage to her, take her out, or if I'm wasting an ability right now.
Yep.
And then you have to like move from then on forth with that information.
Yes.
She, playing a little bit more reactionary seems to be the way to go with her, because like she has this mobility with the ascend, mm-hmm. and this ability to mitigate that damage. So like you being a little bit more vigilant, I guess, about her mobility is what's important. I could totally imagine getting lost, like losing her in a team fight.
Yeah.
You know, with that ascend, like with the movement, like over some of the like wall, like getting around some of the corners and monolith, like really cutting that vision off, I think is be super important in team fights for her.
Right. Yeah, it's really quick. She's very elusive, in that way.
So in
champion right yeah. now.
Killing it.
Is the
it's reported.
That's the rule. That's the rule. When you say when you say you're last hit god, you miss the next one. With a lot of the laning phase, you were speaking earlier because we were kind of talking about like who might fit well with her.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that like, you know, she's laning with Steel here, we were talking about earlier how much some of the trouble she might experience in laning phase with that melee.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a trade-off you guys take sometime, maybe in some of your comp games, is where you're like, yeah, we'll take a melee support with Sereth in the laning phase in order to have that superior maybe team fight capability of that melee support later on?
Mm-hmm.
Or am I going to take the safe bet of having the support to get Sereth to that point? Like, what is there a preferential to kind of a game by game basis?
So I think if you're playing with a team, your picks should be the number one thing that dictate picks should be composition. So I think that there are times where you can put her with a melee support, but only if it's because that's what makes your team work. In a vacuum, if you're looking at just the lane, then she's probably you probably really want a range support with her. Reason being is she has a difficult early game as well, where she needs to be babysat.
Yeah. Right. No, but I mean, and you can kind of see like she's a little bit flimsier. She's flimsy, similar to a ranger. I mean, a carry early on, and that's the sort of thing where being melee, in addition to having that lower like survivability in lane, is you kind of compounds that. So you got to be a little bit safer, I imagine.
Even best case scenario, two melee heroes would have trouble with a ranged offlaner, and then that's compounded by if one of those is her, and
right.
like someone like a Steel.
So when do you kind of feel that you, I mean, and people often use this term with carries of coming online, like when do you feel like on Sereth you really feel like the strength? Is it when you hit that, like that Blade of Agor, or is it more of a level or a time period?
So I would say you start being a threat as soon as you're 5. Not to say that you want to like roam and look for fights right then or anything like that, but you have to be respected. When you have your ult, as far as like when you start coming online, it's when the Blade of Agor gets finished.
Okay, so I'm at 4 right now. What's the next choice? Is it the Q? Do you go with Heaven's Fury?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Take 6 seconds off of that cooldown.
Yeah, so this is one of those things, and like I know people had talked about this initially when, you know, we went on the monolith and people saw a lot of Steel's ultimate. They had, there was like questions about dodging it with, you know, from some people found some success with Countess, some people found some success with Blink charming out. But now with Sereth, you have another option as a carry to dodge those large teamfight ultimates with Heaven's Fury. So I think that's going to be very important, especially leveling that up early on. You get that cooldown lower. That's a threat, and that's another thing you have to keep track of in a teamfight.
Yeah.
And adding the things that people have to keep track of, it just increases your chance, I think, of coming out on top. But I can understand that, like, if you do get a little bit aggro, like, of course, here, you know, Kayle clearly masterfully just already playing Sereth.
Yeah.
But
I'm well practiced.
In a team fight scenario, maybe using that ascend could immediately turn the tables, though. So that's another thing you have to be careful about for people, you know, who want to try and play Sereth tomorrow. A carry, like being that melee carry, that ascend, I'm sure, is super important.
Yeah, very much so. In fact, there are some, like Beacon, for instance, we talk about this a lot. He says that he would prefer to dodge things with ascend as opposed to Q, because I forget what his reasoning is, but basically he can dodge and disengage, as opposed to like if you just use Q to dodge something, you're still just standing
in that
there.
Area, right? It'd be tantamount to using like a stasis or something and just being stuck in that area.
Yeah.
The enemies know where you are. They know where the damage needs to go next.
Yeah.
I feel like Heaven Theory is more of a niche dodging abilities where I'm dodging high impact abilities, whereas Ascend's more of like the everyday use.
Yeah, it's a dodge. It's not escape. If it's a situation where you're going to dodge and then immediately ascend, you might as well just ascend.
Right. That's true.
And just a small little thing, just a little tip. When you're playing her, you want to make sure it's really appetizing to use Q on people running away from you. But if you're chasing somebody, you really do not want to do that because you'll hit them, but then you're going to be right back to where you started when the ability is over, and they'll probably be really far away. Okay. So resist the urge to Q people unless that Q
unless
is going
to
kill people.
Unless you know it's going to be a finisher.
Yes, exactly. Okay.
So here is something that I think... people want to see is the ultimate. So I'm just gonna use it and then walk around for a little bit. Once you have it active, it lasts for 15 seconds.
I believe it's 18 seconds.
18 seconds, is that max, or is it?
I think it's 18 at all levels. What changes?
Yeah, it is 18. You're right. Yeah. It is 18.
When you level it, she gets the weaken gets stronger.
Okay.
Let's get this guy. Smite him.
I want him to come chase me.
Get him with the heavens.
Ooh.
So we activated it.
You want to make sure you're weaving abilities in between all those. Yeah.
Nice.
Very nice.
Yeah, so you kind of like, as soon as he used that Heaven's Fury, like, I kind of noticed that he started, like, as soon as he started weaving those abilities in, like, it became a lot more considerable. Like, it felt like, initially, you're kind of like, all right, she used ultimate, like, I can expect these certain things, but the actual impact doesn't, I guess, become immediately noticeable until you are engaged in the fight.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the initial engage, I feel like, is going to see that immediate burst. But when you get into the fight, you're starting to swing away. They're taking the weakened damage, they're taking the burn damage, and you're also just, you know, doing that extra damage and weaving the abilities, and that's when you start seeing the damage drop. Like, it's not the initial burst, but it's like a... incremental increase.
So like the first hit isn't super chunky,
right.
But it's like the second, the third hit, all those together, really chunky. I believe the burn lasts for 3 seconds. It's just about making sure that stays applied.
It's consistent.
Right,
okay.
Right.
So hope you guys really enjoyed this stream. We wanted to, again, bring you guys some gameplay, talk about Seraph, and I made a lot of new friends.
Yeah.
Thank you guys. Thank you.
Just a big fan.
Thank you. I'm very happy about that. But yeah, thanks James for coming on.
Thank you.
Under
thank you for having me.
The circumstances, weather, crazy. We will be back with an extended play of Seraph on Wednesday to kind of talk through the hero a little bit more. But we're going to bring on the community folks, Be So Sneaky. They're going to do some art. It should be a really good time. I think everyone will be pleasantly surprised if you get into Seraph's kit, how you can utilize her on the battlefield. First melee carry. And Paragon is coming tomorrow. The build will be out early.
Yes,
so early. We'll be back to our very, very early build releases, excuse me. So when you wake up, you should be able to play. If there's any issues, we'll make sure to update you guys. And before I leave...
Well, I was gonna drop something before you drop that.
Okay.
Real quick, for tomorrow, the notes, we'll have the notes up for you guys tomorrow. Around the same time we normally post, 10 to noon. I'd keep an eye out for the notes. And then as well, there is a bug tomorrow in tomorrow's build with PS4 players having some trouble. Team comms are not functioning correctly when players are dead on PS4 controllers. We have an immediate fix for that coming in on
Wednesday.
The goal is to come in on Wednesday for that fix. So you may have noted that in the TLDR, just like making sure everybody knows that. But but Kale, if you want to go on to that.
Yeah,
I feel like you have something to say.
There's
something we might have missed.
For those of you that might be new,
that's right.
Every time we do a dev stream, we drop some lore. And I'm sure this one is a little bit, I'd say this one is a little bit more in depth than the lore that we've given.
Our lore is definitely getting more spicy over time.
Yeah, it's getting spicy. We're spicing it up a little bit. So we wanted to tell you guys a little bit more about Seraph. Shouldn't take too long. This is a much, much better than the Gideon is an evil dude.
We've come far.
We've come much more than that. He's evil. Gideon's evil. If you didn't know, he's evil. No, but Seraph, lore story. So she was engaged in a battle. It was a battle with her on one side and some other group on the other side. Not going to get into those details. Severok appeared on the battlefield. Severok. You guys know he's a mean guy.
He's right mouse buttoned in.
He came through and wiped out everyone on the battlefield. Both sides. Didn't care. He's Severok. He's soul stacking. He's siphoning.
He's siphoning. He doesn't.
He's siphoning.
He can't be bothered. Can't be bothered.
He approached Sereth, and instead of killing her or engaging in battle, he let her live. I'm sure some of you might be asking, like, why would
he do that?
Why
Kale?
Would Severok why, do why a thing would that like happen? That? Well, he sensed something in her, a darkness in her, if you will. And she had to contemplate that. And she there's more to the story, yeah. But she had to contemplate that. And she, as you guys heard, wants to get revenge on Severok for basically wiping out the people that she knew. So there is a lore story for you guys. Probably the most in-depth one that we've done so far here on the stream. So yes. I hope you guys enjoyed today's live stream. We will be back, hopefully, on a normal schedule with the release of our next hero. We'll have the dev stream on, do our normal thing. You guys get to learn about how we built the hero. But again, weather here, crazy. Looking forward to the next one. Can't wait for Sereth to come out tomorrow. And again, James, thank you for being
thank
on.
You thank
on.
You. Yeah. Thank you.
So we will see you guys.
The Book of the Vigilant foretold her coming. She will walk in the light. But in her heart is pure darkness. And a thirst for revenge.